Members, can I declare the Economic and Community Development Committee meeting for the 18th of October open? Can I commence by indicating that the Economic and Community Development Committee and the next committee, the Finance and Business Services Committee, public meetings will both be streamed live and recorded for publishing on the internet. Please note that an audio and visual recording is taken of this meeting. This means that your presence at and any or all contribution you make to the meeting may be collected, used, disclosed or published publicly by the council, including transferring outside of Australia. The Economic and Community Development Committee acknowledges that we're meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains, and we pay our respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge they are of continuing importance for the Kaurna people living today. I have an apology from Councillor Slama. I think apart from that, we're all present. Councillor Antic is here, but on the phone. So we'll be in a minute, I hope. But given that we've got a quorum, we'll keep going. Can I have someone move confirmation of the minutes of the last meeting, please? Moved by Councillor Carahan, seconded by Councillor Corbell. All those in favour of adopting the minutes, that's carried. There's no public forum this evening. I don't have a formal report, so can I move to items for adoption on block? I'll do a call over. Please call out if you have something that you'd like us to discuss tonight. Agenda item 7, display of items stored in archives. Councillor Martin. Item 8, Smart City Transformation Initiative business cases. So, question if you're going to pull it out?
No, I'm going to pull it out. No one else. It's fairly important. It's $12 million. I'm surprised. No one wants to pull it out.
Councillor Vershaw. Update to 30-year plan for Greater Adelaide draft for a consultation. Councillor Martin. Union Street proposal.
Councillor Antic has an amendment to that.
Indeed, he has. So thank you, Councillor Antic. Thank you for reminding me, Councillor Martin Moran. Item 11, items for a committee to receive a note. Nothing of those. Item 12, out of session information papers. The first one of those is, does anyone want to pull out that item? One relates to the Administration of Food Act and the other relates to notice of engagement and research activities. Well, we're content with that one going through. So I need someone to move. Really, it's only item 12, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Can I have someone move item 12? Moved by Councillor Mullane, seconded by Councillor Corbell. All those in favour of item 12? Members, all those in favour of item 12? That's carried. Thank you. That brings us back to item 7. Councillor Martin, the floor is yours.
Look, Chair, I will move this as printed.
Right, before you do, let's go to seconder. Mr. Lawman.
Oh, just go straight to the vote then. I will support it, but I just want to draw members' attention to the fact that this is a matter which was raised in 1999, 2009, and now 2016. And the 2009 report recommended that this was going to, concluded that this was indeed an expensive enterprise and that any separate institution, whether within Town Hall or outside of Town Hall, came with what I would regard as prohibitive costs. And so my intention in raising that is to remind the administration of that the costs that we're talking, $2009, $2.4 million, $500,000, $650,000, $750,000, $750,000, all of the options. These are very serious costs, and they are not contemplated except by referring us to the fact that that document exists. And I ask the administration to take that into account and recognise that the elected body at that time judged it to be an expensive option. However, the proposal which receives the least attention is worthy of examination, and that is for a virtual museum at 9.3. These are now something that are quite common throughout the world. There are something in the order of 300 virtual museums. Beginning 20 years ago with New York's Museum of Computer Art, there is now a proliferation of them. And in fact, the CSIRO did some work, I understand, here in Adelaide involving a trial of a virtual museum tour system that uses some kind of new technology. So it's a personal experience for everyone who enters it. And it allows for visitors to the virtual museum to do so from any part of the world. And given that the archive that is held by the Adelaide City Council is primarily an archive that is of documents and images, it may well be much more prudent to be talking about establishing a facility that would have worldwide access. Minimal setup cost in terms of the digitization process, which is already underway, and none of the capital costs and none of the ongoing costs that were anticipated in that study from 2009. So I say, look, I understand what's being proposed, but really there is a way to go, and I would ask the administration to examine that.
Lord Mayor, seconder.
Thank you, Chair. Well, I'm pleased Councillor Martin speaking in support of this, Chair. I do too. And of course, what we're agreeing to here, Chair, is really just an investment into some infrastructure so that we can display more of what's in our archive. And then the second part of the motion, of course, is to then do a further investigation, including the cost-benefit analysis, which the staff will do. So in the first instance, the kind of great fan members that we get more of what we've got on archive out in display so that more South Australians and more of our residents in the City of Adelaide can enjoy it and appreciate it. We often have discussions around heritage and so forth. Well, what a wonderful opportunity this is, Chair, to put more of our city's history. I mean, we are the first local government in Australia. That's something to be celebrated, I think, all the time. So let's get more of our stories out on display so that more people here at Adelaide Town Hall and possibly some of our other sites can enjoy and appreciate the history of the city of Adelaide. I think it's a worthy thing. So what we're endorsing here is a $34,000 spend on some infrastructure and then a report which will come back to us in due course. So I think it's well founded, and Councillor Martin's comments regarding digitisation and so forth are also very well founded. So I commend this to members, Chair.
Any other members wish to speak to this item, or can I put it? Councillor Wilkinson.
Just commending the administration for taking this up. It's long overdue. Thank you. We have an incredible resource which is not buried away in the bowels of the top of the wall currently, and in such a way as not to be showcasing something that we should be well far of. Exploiting to the mattress is proposing to explore the third, and I think the virtual thing is something that can complement rather than the space. Who wants a tourist just to come here? not have a look at it.
Indeed, we do. Councillor Corbell.
Thank you. Yeah, I think it's a bit of a shame that we've got so many treasures down in our archives and in our storage facilities to not have them on display. And this, for a small sum of money, for $34,000, we're able to buy some display cases, which will give us portability, and we can rotate around exhibitions, around our community centres, the box factory, libraries, and also housing them in Town Hall, which is good for tourism and it's good for our local ratepayers, and it becomes a new attraction for the city. So I think it's good for everybody, and it's really good value for money, and it's a long-term investment because once we have the display cases, they can be used for many years to come. And also there's the potential in the years ahead to work with History SA on a proper dedicated site of the City Museum to tell the story of the city, which is something that can go into further work.
Thank you, Councillor Corbell. Any other members, or can I put it, or back to you to sum up, Councillor Martin?
Yes, thank you, Chair. And look, I acknowledge that Councillor Corbell raised this originally, and I endorse the principle there should be more access to documents. It's just that I don't have the same enthusiasm for a large building. But nevertheless, I will support this and I urge other members to do so.
Thank you, Councillor Martins. Can I put that, all those in favour? All those against? That's carried. Item 8, Councillor Bershaw.
Thank you, Chair. Can I speak to it before I move the...
I'm happy to move.
Moved by Councillor Abiyat, and seconded by Councillor Malani. You happy to reserve your right? You too, Councillor? Now you can, Councillor Bershaw.
Thank you. Look, I'm a little bit surprised to tell the truth that we would approve the release of $6.8 million without any discussion. I would like to thank the administration. I know that they've made every attempt to speak to as many councillors, if not all of the councillors, in the lead up to this paper coming in. And there's been a lot of work, and I felt very comfortable or much uncomfortable after having the talk with Director Mottler and with Peter all this afternoon. One of the things I did want to just refer to, because I guess my concern is things like the business case against city car parking, for instance. The option doesn't actually address the strategic move of strategic objective of moving towards an expiation-free environment. Now, that is on page 39. My understanding from council is that a lot of our supporting the business case, and that is a very high number that is against this business case, was that we're supporting that so that we do go to an expiation-free environment. And so I'm sort of, particularly that business case was the one that I thought deserved further interrogation, because I just need to make sure that we're all on the same page. Obviously, the things like expanding the Wi-Fi, all of these things are fantastic and they completely underpin our smart moves, our smart strategy. I just was on, and I am of the opinion that this body of work deserves more time to sit down and talk to the administration about how it's connected and how the information is going to be applied. For instance, the data that might be used for city businesses, how actually are we going to apply the data? Because data, unless it has a proper application and we can demonstrate that here we're benchmarking here and we double the number of businesses in the city over the next 5 years, that data isn't actually, or the collection of that data has no value. So I did have a bit of a discussion with administration this afternoon as to how we can sort of interrogate the same, that information, the same with customer service, what that actually means for our customer service benchmarks, what it means for our delivery, what it means for how we become easier to do business with. And so basically with a view that perhaps each of those directors or associate directors are afforded the opportunity to talk about how this work is going to be implemented through their programs, and so that we have a really clear view on the expending of money and just how that is going to be used and what that outcome is.
Councillor Bershaw, the CEO and I anticipated that there might be some councillors who wanted to interrogate this information in more detail between now and next week perhaps. And so if I can hand over to the CEO who's willing to make available staff so that we can do that interrogation.
Yeah, through the Chair. Some council members are entirely comfortable with this series of recommendations. Others do seek slightly more information. So between now and next Tuesday, I'm happy to make staff available to sit down with those interested council members that just wish to go through it in a little bit more detail. Because there is a lot of information, and a lot of work that has been done. It's a matter of becoming aware of that and asking some more questions. So if you'd like, we can set aside some time where individual council members or collections of council members can just meet with the staff and go through and become a little bit more comfortable and a bit more aware. We can do that during the week.
I wonder whether we could just identify a time and then those people who are interested could get, you know, let people know whether they can make it or not. I'd certainly appreciate the opportunity, and I think others may too. Yeah. Councillor Richard, do you wish to go on? Councillor Abia, then back to you. You reserved your right. Do you wish to speak now or do you just want to maintain your reservation?
No, I'm happy to speak.
Okay.
Look, I'll be brief. This is a really exciting project. I'll be honest with you all, when we even contemplated the very thought of locking in $70 million in budget before coming to this, I was going, wow, this is such a progressive move by council, because unlike any other project we do, this is not tangible. This is not one you can point to where there is a road that's being built or there is a specific sculpture that's being put in place or a mall that's being developed. This is a cloud-based infrastructure, it's digital-based infrastructure, and it takes some serious, some seriousness for a council to be as open to even give this a go. Because this is one of those things where you've got to keep spending money on. Like, this is not just something that is going to happen overnight. And there'll be, as Councillor Virgil mentioned before, potentially, yes, it might not have the impact or the returns we expect on some of our revenue and parking, because in implementing technology around, completely having a zero-based revenue when it comes to fines, we'll potentially find savings in staffing. We might find savings in better systems or other elements around data capture, around planning for cities, vehicle movements. There's a whole heap of things that will fit into it. So what we need to do is not to try to look at this in specific silo outcomes either for our organisation. We need to understand that the digital strategy implementation across the whole organisation will deliver savings for this council over decades to come. We need to trust it. We need to keep trusting it. We need to believe in our staff. It's like Telstra many years ago installing PSTN copper cables, not thinking Wi-Fi will come. You can't stop with technology. The minute you stop and you pull back, ultimately you'll end up very far back in the race. And you have systems that will be legacy systems before you even launch. And we've seen this currently. I don't think we need to go very far with the NBN federally. If they know the technology we have today, NBN is redundant. We don't need it. It's just governments are always very slow to react to technology, and we need to stay ahead on this one, not behind, because potentially digitally, this is where we can connect across different organisations, different council areas, find a lot of savings, and potentially provide a better service for our constituents. So it might be so. Now, we don't go down the line of a council. This might be a digital amalgamation. I mean, that's what it might be. If it matters to constituents that the civic nature of councils remain, then digitally we may amalgamate. There might be different options at which we could do things. So, look, I think we're doing some groundbreaking stuff here in council. We need to be proud of it. But I implore members, please have faith and give this a go, because I know we can't feel it yet and we can't put our finger on it. And there is an element of risk. I'm not going to take that. There isn't an element of risk of this. But we've got to be in it together. It's one of those things where you just need to believe and keep going. And I'm confident we'll get good results. So, look, this is a great outcome. I've never dreamed ever to be able to get this outcome out of council. So, well done to all of you that have supported it. It's a really, really big advancement for us.
Councillor Milani, a second, did you wish to?
I agree. That's a hard act to follow, because, as well said, Councillor Abiad. And also just note that the business case that are outlined in this document are actually, there is some tangible, I can actually feel personally that they are quite tangible. So there's some good measures in there, so I think it's an exciting piece of work.
Councillor Martin.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Taking up Councillor Abiad's point, not the one about digital amalgamation, because I might feel uncomfortable about that. But, I can't put my finger on it. I want to just acknowledge that, yes, I support all of these measures, they are in the main trials, or alternatively changes to dashboards and experiences that people will have in dealing with council the digital economy. The most significant measure is the parking census proposal, which will be rolled out from this time next year. I note in the report that it is expected that far from becoming a expiation-free environment, there's an expectation that fines will go up at least in the short term, before they come down. And I want to, at this point, express gratitude that the option that was proposed in the city parking experience business case that included turning over 2,400 currently unpaid spaces to paid spaces has been dismissed. And I would ask that that continues to be the case, that throughout this whole rollout process, that there is no conversion of unpaid spaces to paid spaces, because it will risk disenchanting city visitors, ratepayers and the like, and may in fact alienate them to the changes that are proposed. But I just want to ask, and maybe it's something that can be covered in the briefing that was proposed by the CEO, that we have an explanation of what are the efficiencies that are gained. Now, it's discussed quite clearly in here that there are substantial increases in costs, becoming of the order of $500,000 a year by 2020, and that there will be an efficiency dividend, but it's not identified anywhere in the document. There is no identification of savings through reduction in salary costs and operating costs and the like. And it would be very helpful, as one of my ratepayers keeps telling me, to have an account of what it is that we get out of this. What is it that the ratepayers are getting in terms of savings and efficiencies? So I will support this, but it would be nice to have all of that information to be able to be making an informed decision.
Well, I notice that Councillor, that Claremont has noted that down while you were speaking, so I think we can take that as the administration having captured that notion, and we'll make sure that that's part of any briefing that's made available to us between now and next week. And I'm sure Claire will be in touch about setting up a time for us. Anybody else wish to speak to this? Yes, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Chair. And of course, this is consistent with the 16-17 budget of Council and our 2016-2020 strategic plan, which positions us as a smart, green, livable, creative city. I love doing that, smart, green, livable, creative. But smart city, I think these type of investment also, as Councillor Abbeyard said, and this is going to really kind of, I think, close to a position of national leadership. So, and it's all about improving the experience for the user of the City of Adelaide, for the visitor of the City of Adelaide, for the resident of the City of Adelaide, for the business owner of the City of Adelaide. And that's what the whole intent of this investment is. And I think it also sits extremely comfortably alongside the parallel project, which we're investigating around 10 Gig City, which will come back to us next year. So I think this is all telling a very similar story. I too want to see tangible benefit. You invest into IT infrastructure. I mean, these are the outward facing projects, but I know we're also investing into a number of inward facing projects which improve our own smart organisation efficiencies. But you invest into these things to improve efficiency, to improve response times, to improve the user experience and to reduce cost. So I too, as I'm sure many elected members also will want to see, is how does this ultimately translate to cost reductions in terms of our operating costs? I've got one comment, and I will certainly, Chair, explore this further in the discussion from the meeting kindly offered by the CEO. Is I note in the recommendation that it involves expansion of the city Wi-Fi, which is wonderful and absolutely warranted, but I think we'd also like to see an increase in the speed of the city Wi-Fi too, so that's something we can talk about offline. But I endorse this, so certainly thank you for your enthusiasm behind it, members. Thank you.
Thank you, Aubrey. Back to you to sum up, I think.
So just in summarising, great comments from everyone. Just imagine there will be a future where digital infrastructure will be delegated to the CEO. I mean, this will be like a park bench, it will be like a footpath, it will be like a street. This is not something we'll discuss. I mean, imagine a future where even the internet will be part of the rates. It's just an expected service that every single person will get. It's a lot closer than what we think it may be. It really is. And it's every city that we're all competing on the same level here. So look, I think having I think being brave and bold to go out and do this is going to be really exciting. And I'm really looking forward to seeing some of the results come through. As every elected member said, we want to see the dividends payback. And I'm sure we will do that, hopefully sooner than later. So thank you, members, for supporting.
Thank you, Councillor Abbott. So can I put that item 8 All those in favour? That's carried. Thank you. Which brings us to item 9, Councillor Martin.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Look, a question for the administration first before I begin. The accompanying document, which is attachment B, I have some proposals that I would like the administration to take into account. Is it necessary for those to be moved as an amendment, or is discussion simply enough?
Which staff member is going to be addressing this for us? So this relates to our response to the updated plan, and the table that's there is attachment B. So
through the chair, the recommendation says that you are adopting the content contained within attachments A and B. So if you wish to change any content within that, it's probably best to do it in this manner.
So we can do that subject to some subject to some amendments, if you'd like that, Councillor Martin. Would you like someone to move it and second it to get us started? Yeah, so moved by Councillor Maloney and seconded by Councillor Moran. Do you wish to speak to it, Councillor Maloney? Reserve your right. Councillor Moran, reserve your right. Okay, so but it's back to you, Councillor Martin, if you wanted to propose some amendments, and it could be subject to the following amendments.
Okay. Look, I have to say that this draft 2030 plan encapsulates all of the things that some of us have worried about the government's intentions in respect of heritage in the parkland. It is a revealing document, but I am grateful to the administration for the changes that have been proposed that will have an impact on, or could have had an impact on North Adelaide, P4, P19, P22, and A9, H35. They're all good amendments. But in respect of the parklands at P14 on our page 56, the observation of the administration that organic form implies a an open to ad hoc changes approach is the point is well made. And I would, for the sake of clarity, like to propose that the recommendation is that the document be approved subject to an amendment to P14's recommendation, which advocates the replacement of organic form with open space. That, in my view, more correctly addresses the circumstances. That is to say, we are talking about the role of the parklands in a built environment. Additionally, I didn't support and don't support, but I'm not going to propose an amendment because it won't get up and I'll waste everyone's time.
Councillor Martin, can I just get you to...
That's the recommendation. Yes, the point that I'm making is that P14, which is the reference...
I think we've got that up.
Yes.
So my question is, are there any other, because we need a seconder, so are there any other amendments? We can just get the amendments down. Yeah, but it's not, my question is, has he got the amendment in full yet?
No, I will stick with that one.
That's it? That's the only amendment? Okay, great. So that's seconded by Councillor Farahan. So, okay, let's talk to
him. Okay, what I'm saying, the Lord Mayor is wondering what we're talking about.
Yeah.
The 30-year plan references at P14, page 44, strengthen the overall built form of the city characterised by a grid pattern of streets and squares contrasting with the organic form of the parklands. The administration's point is the description of the form of the Adelaide parklands as organic should be reviewed. The layout derives from the formal plan and is largely intact. Better wording would be open and landscape character of the parklands. The term organic implies open to ad hoc change. The recommendation of the administration, however, is to clarify the intent regarding the parklands with due regard to the national heritage values of the Adelaide city layout and parklands. So all I'm proposing is that that's cut up by deleting all reference to organic, so it becomes open spaces, although I'm still open to the use of the open and landscape character of the parklands, but open spaces seems to my mind, better describe the parklands as they are, rather than, as the administration observes, as subject to change by being an organic form. It's a, well, I think the organic form does actually imply that it is something that's ever changing. And while it may be ever changing in the context of the street grids, patterns of squares and so forth, it is a contrast with open landscape spaces, not something that's open to ad hoc change. And that is the purpose of the amendment. It doesn't change anything, and indeed I'd be very surprised if it changed anything in the government's mind. I'd be very surprised if they accepted that change. But it is, in my view, the minimum. And I would argue page 95 that there's a reference to our strategic plan and how we'll work with the state government and regional councils on the parklands. I've never accepted that. So I'm not going to oppose that change. So, members, I'm just saying this is a sensible change to something which the government's 2030 plan could allow for misinterpretation. The administration's observation is right. The strength of the recommendation, however, is, in my view, not strong enough. And therefore, that amendment would address that issue.
Councillor Clarahan, a second. Do you wish to be amended? Do you wish to speak to it? Councillor Moran?
I'm happy to make that clear, but when I read that in the plan, organic, I took it as organic as against non-organic, rather than, I mean, there are two civil meanings of organic. Organic can be something constantly changing, but also means something alive. So I was comfortable. If this doesn't get up, I'll foreshadow that open space worries me a bit, because you can have paved open space, you can have baseball open space. I was happy with organic. I'd be happy if we put if this loses, that we've just put what we see as the meaning of organic. What's that called?
Councillor Moran, I wonder, definition. I wonder if it would be helpful to get our administration to comment, because they might have some ideas about understanding Councillor Martin's intent.
It was meant to be.
Yeah. So, Shanti, could you just comment on the having listened to the debate, could you give us some comment on whether this is achieving it or whether there might be another way? Thanks.
Through the chair, really the concern that administration have is not necessarily the wording organic, but more so the intent of recognising the national heritage value of the parklands. In the context of the conversation that's being had currently, whether the term organic or open space is used is probably inconsequential in relation to the intent to have recognised the fact that the parklands are on the National Heritage Register.
So you think the wording is fine either way, is really what you're saying?
Exactly.
And the intent will be delivered either way?
Yes.
Councillor Moran, does that set your mind at rest?
Yes, we're just looking at the definition of organic, and it does living. It doesn't. We talk about organic change, don't we? But it's the change part of that couple of words that means change. Organic change means that it's come from within, like internal change, isn't it? Whereas non-organic change is implies from above. So that's a bit of a jingoistic popular phrase, using the word organic. And I'm perfectly happy with organic. If it feels happy. I'm happy. Open space, I think.
Doesn't.
Okay. I'm just going to read the plan. I know that somebody might. I say open space is fine. So we can put in the big Asheville thing for Cirque du Soleil to go on, because that's open and it's space. So we don't want any loopholes to be on the front room.
Yeah, I think. Well, Councillor Moran, you've. Do you have anything more you want to say on that?
That's it.
Okay. Does anybody else wish to speak to the amendment? Then back to Councillor Martin to sum up on the amendment.
Look, I just reiterate that organic form still means for me something which is changing constantly in an ad hoc form. There is no structure to it. And therefore, a replacement with a description, and I'm happy with one of open and landscape character in the parklands, or open spaces. They both denote the same thing, but look, I don't want to have a debate about semantics. It is the view of everyone that organic is a groovy word, then that's fine, I'll put to where it is.
Okay, so all those in favour of the amendment proposed by Councillor Martin? Yeah, yeah. Let's do that. 1, 2, 3. Can we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6? What's that? That's carried.
You've got 11, 6, 5, yep.
That's carried. So that takes us back to the substantive. Councillor Malone?
Just move it, there were no other speakers.
Are there any other speakers? Councillor Malone, you reserved your right. Councillor Abbey, do you reserve your right? Do you wish to speak? Or?
What?
Going back to the substantive motion?
No, I'm good.
Okay, then Councillor Malani can sum up. Okay, then that's summed up. Can I put that? All those in favour? That's carried. Thank you. Takes us to item 10. Councillor Antic, your colleague, Councillor Moran, pulled this out on your behalf in your absence. I understand you've got a an alternate motion.
I do, I'm indebted to Councillor Moran for doing so.
So the alternate motion is on the screen, I believe. We need a seconder for that.
Yes, I see the seconder.
And I think Councillor Moran indicated by email that she was willing to second the. Yeah. Okay, so over to you, Councillor Moran.
Reasonably straightforward, and I will be brief. The proposal to address the issue of the amenity down in Union Street, I think, is a really good one. I don't have any problem at all with the concept of adding to the streetscape. I think the photos do that quite, tell that story quite well. It's an area which no doubt there are some plans for use and plans for outdoor use. So I think it's a good opportunity to do that. What I'm puzzled by though is why absolutely requires on-street car parking to be impacted in this manner. I mean, it would strike me that if we are to remove a car park from that area, an area which is particularly relevant to businesses and indeed local residents, then there would be a quid pro quo type arrangement whereby it's taken from one hand, it's given with the other. And it just strikes me that this is an issue of a death by a thousand cuts in one sense. We seem to be continually coming up with good ideas for use of public realm and public space, but the victim seems to be the motor vehicle. And it strikes me that there is a sort of a trend which has continuing on and has been continuing for some time. So I think there really needs to be, and particularly given the motion, the smart move remedy motion, which looked to try and address some of these issues with encouraging motor vehicle transport in the city. I think there really needs to be a statement made here that if we are to remove these areas, then every attempt must be made to return car parking, on-street car parking to the area which it's removed from. Point 9 of the report actually talks to that. It says that the footpath proposal is a relatively minor one, however car parking is highly valued in the area and any loss of parking is likely to create significant concern for East End precinct businesses. Well, we're continually seem to be removing car parks and even in this case replacing them with five motor scooters or motorbike parks, that's fine. That's something which I think with Councillor Slammer's very sensible motion to have those put onto the footpaths can be done in conjunction. So I just don't see why there's a need to rob Peter to pay Paul in this instance. And we've seen it time and time again. This was part of the rationale behind my smart move remedy motion in order to try and address this issue. I mean, the motor vehicle is progressing towards energy efficiency. Vehicles, we're going to see an increased number of electric and potentially even hydrogen-based cars. I don't want to see this city cut off to the option of car parking. Car parking and cars in the city are what bring people to the city and bring people to our businesses and pay our rates. So it's important, and I can't see another reason why we can't go to any length to try and replace it somewhere else. So seek support.
Thanks, before we go to the other speakers, and I've got a number of them here, I just wonder if we might get some administrative comment on this issue. Who's the appropriate, Daniel? Only in that I know there's been some very detailed fine-grained work done down in this part of the city about finding every possible car park there is available, because it is a big issue for this area. And I just want to comment about whether we're saying to in or near this area, whether it is actually practical.
Through the chair, in 2015 we completed around an 18-month study in the East End on car parking spaces, and a review at that time found that all the parking spaces were fully utilised to the best of their capacity. If we were to look at replacing this car park space with a similar one in the near vicinity, it would mean impacting other operations in the street. So we would need to, for example, remove the proposed motorbike parking, or we may need to impact a queuing period in other parts of the street to the car park. We can investigate that and bring the options back to council.
Thank you.
Ask a question, if it's appropriate. Just a question, not a comment.
Yep, just one question, and then I've got some number of speakers. So
yeah, just a follow up on that. In relation to that study, I remember that the East End Coordination Group was involved in also providing some feedback on what works and doesn't work for them. In what's been proposed in relation to this, have they been consulted in relation to the removal of that car park? Because they were consulted the whole way before.
As part of the council's process for removal or changing the on-street car park spaces, they have been given the opportunity to provide feedback, and that's in the link document attached to this report.
Okay. Thank you. Now, I've got Councillor Moran as seconder.
Which is
Lord Mayor, you're next. Then Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Corbell.
Thank you, Chair. I might be Councillor Antic's fairy godmother on this debate, because, of course, with the advent of the Oban on the immediate area of East Terrace and London Road, Chair, is that there will be the creation of some 40-plus new car parks, which we're yet to see the final design of. But, of course, car parking in the East End, and Councillor Antic is exactly right, is a very sensitive issue because of the volume of small businesses in the area. But one of the outcomes, and of course one of the outcomes which was pivotal, Chair, towards securing the support of the residential and commercial groups in the East End with regards to the Oban, the design of the Oban, which ultimately went underground, was the provision of more car parks through the East Terrace and London Road. Now, I believe that will come back to us relatively soon. So, Councillor Antic could possibly take some comfort that we might lose one on Union Street, but we might pick up 44 to 45 within about 100 metres. So.
Thank you. Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Corbell, Councillor Adrian.
They're having had my business in the East End, and these terraces on the keep aware of how tight our parking is, which is around there. And there is actually out the front of Gladys C. Churns. There is an on-street bicycle parking, which is taking up the car park. Josh Chappell owned Gladys and Chains. They did rather impact the car park that was there. That sort of on-street bicycle parking could be existing on a footpath and not precluding a car park. So to act on this motion that gets up in the immediate vicinity around the corner of Union Street, we could remove that bicycle parking and put it on a footpath so it doesn't preclude things that we can have bikes and cars, not bikes in lieu of cars. And that's the way I'd like us to go about it. Just as I'd like to see motorbike parking in places where they're too small to fit a regular car park, and only there, again, not motorbike parks in places where you could get a normal car park. Because there's plenty of room to fit and as a cyclist, I would usually park my bike against a council car parking pole, because they're all over the place, and they make perfect hitching place, and ample opportunity for cyclists to bike without having to take up an on-street park. Which I know the trader of that shop particularly wasn't consulting, rather than having a car park in front of the shop than and I would like to commend the proposal from Peregrine to sleeve the use in behind this facade. And we previously would have seen proposals where some heritage consultants said, oh, that facade should not be heritage listed. It just shows why even the facade should be heritage listed, because this is what can happen. If the facade is still there, then, you know, you can criticise facade as some examples Grenfell Street, just at the south of them. But this is what can happen. You can, if the facade is still there, you can build and sleeve in behind and regain the use behind the facade. Once the facade's gone, that opportunity is lost. So I commend the proponents. I'd like to support the proposal, but also I think that's a real opportunity which would be appreciated.
Councillor Corbell, Councillor Elliott.
Thank you. Well, I think this is an excellent development. I'm introducing a mix of retail and cafe into the sleeve heritage frontage. It's really going to be a good fit for this street. On the western side, the eastern side has already got a number of cafes and retail shops, and this side has been, it's a beautiful facade, and why not activate it? I think it's going to be a real enhancement. And to hinge this on a car park, to me, is not a worthwhile decision for this council to make and to support. I'm happy to support the original, and I won't be voting in support of this, in light of all of the extra car parking spaces that we're going to be having made available due to the O-Bahn project, and also because of the 5 motorcycle parks that will be put in place as a result of this. So I think it's an excellent initiative, and I'm really looking forward to seeing it happen.
Councillor Adair, before I go to you, I'm getting an indication from the other end that administration just wanted to make a comment, I think in response to one of the requirements that have already been made, just to clarify something.
Thank you, through the Chair. I'd just like to provide some background on the bike parking and bike lanes in June. It's 1.4 metres, which is smaller than the usual car park space of 2.1 metres. So if a car is parked in that area, it sits outside the car park space and is the bike lane. We get about 75 bikes per day, 70 to 75 bikes, and that converts to 8 to 9 vehicles per day in similar spaces.
Thank you. Councillor Abbott.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Look, just in relation to all of this, we've been quite an inclusive council over the years in consulting with our ratepayers when it comes to this issue, especially in the East End. There's been some issues in the past that some councillors may not be privy to, and this is why the East End Coordination Group is heavily consulted on making sure that the balance of parking we are in the area at least is given a tick from the community and it's supported. So look, I've sort of sometimes spent in the East End about 9 years. We don't have a business there anymore, but there is a close-knit community that work well together and deliver some good outcomes for their area. With that in mind, and if you could look at the objections on page 70, and this is a very open-minded group, the East End Coordination Group strongly objects to the proposed development on Union Street. Losing a car park will impact significantly on stakeholders in the East End. And they've gone to explain that removing one car park equates to the visitors not being able to access the area, etc., etc. There are 3 objections, and although there's one in favour to some degree, even the one in favour actually refers to the Penn University setup, which says let's remove the bikes from there and set up an outdoor dining area, which I have no problems with. I think we should relook at Union Street, especially if there's going to be some development work being done there. But look, I think this is halfway between what we're trying to achieve. It's important that we take the community with us and not, I don't think this whole development council will do is pinging on that car park existing or not existing. It's just a matter of trying to possibly look at other loading zones or other areas in the East End to try to pick up another car park by replacing this car park. The motion here is not saying don't do this. It's saying do it, but try to find another park somewhere else so we can equate the number of car parks. So I think it's fair. And with the level of objection we've received, and especially from the East End Coordination Group, which is not just one organisation, these guys speak to a much larger volume of constituents in the area, I think it's important to take that into account. So by responding back to our community, I think it would be best to say, look, we see value in this development. We see value in changing that car park to other form of parking. However, in response to their concern, let's pick a car park somewhere else or try to find a car park somewhere else, or even change the time of some car park somewhere else. That's all it is. So look, if we could, I think this is a good motion in the sense around keeping the balance, saying, look, we can do this, but let's see what other options we've got in the way of creating another space for the one lost. That's all it is. So look, I'll support that, and I'll take into account the Lord Mayor's comment. When the O-Bahn project's finished and we have those car parks, we'll need to reassess that whole area. Once the hospital moves, we'll need to reassess the whole area. So there'll be plenty of other opportunities for us to relook at this. But if the community perceives that there is an impact now, we need to address the impact now. and it is perceived if it is an impact zone. So I think it's just important for us to look into that. And if you can pick up another space, let's do it. If we can't, let's hear a report back to why we can't and how we can manage that. So I urge members to support the motion at this stage.
Councillor Vershaw, before we come to you, we're bumping up against the meeting time, so I need someone to move to adjourn this meeting. Councillor Malani, seconded by Councillor Corbell. Can I put that this meeting be adjourned? All those in favour? All those that's carried. Councillor Abiot.
I declare the Finance Business Services Committee meeting open, and I move for someone to, I'll ask someone to move to adjourn. Councillor Wilkinson, seconded by Councillor Virtual. All those in favour of adjournment, all those against, that motion is carried.
Thank you, Councillor Abiot. I declare the Economic and Community Development Committee reopened, and over to you, Councillor Virtual.
I'm not in favour of this amendment, though I do draw, that was stolen, but I do draw the attention to point 15 of the report. So I just wanted to ask administration in terms of not having been able to locate an additional space, because what I don't want to see is that we can't do the extension, you know, that one is dependent on the other. So if we're going to seek an additional space, I don't know how far administration has looked for this report, but where might it be possible to find that?
Through the chair, we look at the immediate precincts, so close as possible to Union Street, and then out through to Bundle Street and obviously onto Grenfell. But if we could look further, and we could also then look at options that might compromise other operations of the street, but provide another opportunity to get a parking and bring those back to council.
Okay, so they'll come back to us if you need some additional help. One moment. Councillor Moran, you were next, and then Councillor Corbell, you've spoken, but I think you want a question, but let me just go to Councillor Moran, who hasn't spoken yet.
Look, I do support this. When we support the original one, but I think we should always look to see whether we can replace the car park taken in such a tightly held area. Somebody's already, I can't remember who it was, Freddie Wilkinson's already pointed out that Doug Chappell doesn't want his wide footpath there, and we're quite happy to have another parking space put there. So just off the top of a councillor's head, they've found one. Some of the parking spaces are generous, and perhaps if we put in another councillor, should be able to look at cars like Priscilla's. three sideways spots. I just remember talking about the outdoor dining on the street. For as long as I can remember, Penny University has been asking to have the motorcycle park outside going through by their ward councillor. I'm embarrassed that this one suddenly has popped up. Has there been there hasn't been an application from there has been. Why are we doing this all of a sudden before Penny University?
So through the chair, since writing this report and putting it up to council, we very recently had a proposal come through from Penny University in the past week.
Well, that sounds surprising, because I spoke to Penny University just after the election, and I saw a copy of their proposal. In fact, David Slammer helped them write it, and they put it in. Now, I'd put this on ice till we find out what's going on there. I'm not walking past Penny University tomorrow when they remove another extended footpath for somebody else. I don't know whether, I'm perfectly happy with this amendment, but it's really embarrassing. They've done all the right things. They've gone through their ward councillor. They've got that ward councillor to help with the application. This is a long time ago, and every time I walk past, the man said, "How's that application going?" To which I ring up the ward councillor. So, I'm happy to support this. I think we should always look for more car parks. I park in the street, and they're very handy little car parks there to pop it out for 15 minutes. The businesses are right, removal of a car park in a place like that, you're not going to go to there if you have to park in a car park to quickly pick up something. So it's really important that we find another one. So I urge you, even obviously if you can't find one, you're going to have to come back and say, look, do that. So I have to put that to Councillor Virtual's mind, but I think we need to really you know, put our big girl pants on and go out and find another park there.
Councillor Rand's trying me rather, with that visual idea. I just wondered whether administration could take those issues on board, particularly in relation to Penny Arcade, and whether you'd be in a position to report back to us between Penny University, I mean, and report back to us before the next.
I'll flag the motion with that notice. I'm going to flag the motion with that notice at the end of the meeting around Penny University.
Councillor Corbell, I think you've spoken, but you might have had just a question.
Yeah, my question was, what's the likelihood that you are actually going to, like, does the administration have confidence that if you do broaden your search, you're actually going to find a space to squeeze in another spot if this one is removed? And also, is this going to, like, is this a hinge? If we can't find the space, is it going to stop this from going ahead?
The answer to the first question is that we will ask space or to rework the space that we have available to try to get an extra park here. But we would need to come back to council and provide those options for council. Whether or not it is contingent on the decision depends on the decision of council tomorrow.
Okay. I think everybody who wants to speak has spoken, so we can go back to Councillor Antic to sum up.
I don't want this proposal to be contingent on finding the other car park, and I would offer that we add the words and with consideration of the person moving it, and that where possible a replacement on-street car parking is made available. Because I want to disconnect the two. And the Lord Mayor is telling us that there will be lots more car parks made available, but I wouldn't want to see this project being stopped in the meantime until we find a replacement.
Okay, thanks, Councillor Cohen. So you're suggesting a variation.
Otherwise, I just move it as an amendment. Okay. They won't take it on board.
Okay, so the mover and the seconder, there's been a variation suggested to add the words if possible or where possible. Are you content?
Look, I'm not.
That's it.
Okay. I would like to move that the words and where and that if possible a replacement on street.
Thank you. Councillor Cohen is seeking to is moving an amendment. Is there a seconder to that amendment?
Everyone's
spoken. Anyone not? Councillor Malani hasn't spoken, so she can second it. Councillor Cohen, you've made your point, I think, but you want to add anything?
I don't need to speak any more to it. It's pretty self-evident.
Okay, Councillor Malani, do you wish to speak to it? No, you don't wish to speak to it? Councillor Moran, you wish to speak to the amendment?
Yes, no, I know what Sue is saying, and I'm sympathetic, but it will come back to council if they can't find one. And really, my rule of thumb is when the ward councillors agree on something, I'll put up a motion, you really have to have some very strong reasons to go against their local knowledge. And I will stick with the proposal from the ward council.
Can I bring you back to order, please? Does anybody else wish to speak to the amendment?
It's an organic environment, City Council, Chair.
Councillor Wilkinson, you're wishing to speak to the amendment?
Unless some imperative is put on it, I would just see this won't get action. And the thing is, if the most, without the Green Amendment, then it will compel our administration to relocate some motorbike parks to where a car park can't fit around the country, somewhere like some opportunity like that. Now, that's where there's an opportunity to fix the space, relocating some motorbike parking. It's not that bike parking is where the owner lets the show wants to move.
Councillor Corbell.
I think this is a good amendment. I'm happy to support it. It takes in on board the if possible part, so we will accommodate where we can. And I do have trust in our administration that they will go away and do the work that they can do to broaden the search to squeeze something else in. And I do have confidence that we can accommodate an extra space by changing some other spaces or the way that we use another way further afield. So I see this as a solution.
Yes, you may.
Given the comment made, re small cars, comment made earlier, are we able in the Australian road rules to actually install a car park for a small car?
Wasn't Maddie Priscilla Clark to ask against me anyway?
Okay, but that's a question. Do we want to think of yes or no answer? Okay, members, anybody else wish to speak to the amendment? Otherwise, I'm going back to you, Councillor Sarah, to sum up. And hang on, just one moment.
We are going to get into a situation where next the university are going to ask for their car park, and then it'll just be another space, and then there'll be another one, and then there'll be another one, and another one. The East End coordination group saying here quite rightly that every car park that's removed is approximately 8 customers. So this is, as I said earlier, death of a motor vehicle by 1,000 cuts. We're going to do this over and over again. We've done it outside the British Hotel in North Adelaide. We did it, I think, on Halifax Street. But they're not the only business in the city. So we did it out the front of on Halifax Street. We've done it everywhere. The point is that the overall trend is in order to wage a relentless war on the relevance of the motor vehicle in the city, and I think it's a bridge too far myself. So the first motion, the original amendment, does the job quite properly. And I think the question needs to be asked, if we can't replace our on-street car parks, then should we be doing these sort of jobs? So I don't support the amendment.
Councillor Clare, hand to summer.
I would hate to see this not being able to go ahead because we can't find another car park in Union Street. The Lord Mayor has just said that as a result of the Obam work, there will be 140. How many did you say?
40.
Even so, 45 is 45. That's a huge number of on-street car parks that can be made available in this area. Sure, it's a high demand area, but you also see lots of people on foot. You also see lots of people on bicycles using these businesses, visiting businesses. So, you know, I think it's not a do or die for this business to be able to have an outside area because of one car park. Yes, they're all important, but there will be a lot more car parks in the near future. For goodness sake, let's allow this business to get moving.
Okay, so can I put Councillor O'Farahan's amendment, all those in favour of the amendment?
At the moment, everybody's put their hands up.
Okay, can we everyone get their hands up high so that Julie can see? All those in favour of the amendment?
Is the Lord Mayor voting?
Lord Mayor? Did you? No? Okay. All right, so that's lost? It's
lost.
Okay, so we go back to the substantive motion. And I think everybody has spoken, so it was back to Councillor Antic to sum up.
That's right, yeah, look, I'll very, very briefly, I will sum up. I just had a quick look at some of the, there were 15 responses, and it would seem that the Slammer family has had quite a busy day with the crayon, because the Slammer family are responsible for 3 of them, so we've got a guest call from D Slammer, and we've got the fruit run, and we've got another one from F1 Money. Anyway, just an observation. So having said that, we've got the East End Coordination Group who are opposed to it. So I would encourage members to support the amendment.
Motion.
All those in favour of the motion, not the amendment, all those in favour of the motion, that's carried. Thank you, Councillor Antic. So that brings us to
other business.
Councillor Abiyad, do you identify?
Yeah, look, this was just flagged. I've given the copy that's on there. Seconded as straightforward, I'm not going to speak to it really.
Seconded by Councillor Moran.
So it's just simply that we ask the administration to contact Penny University and assist the providers in exploring opportunities around establishing an outdoor area as per their request. And look, obviously there will be maybe another motion we should bring into council at a later stage of exploring some opportunities around Union Street. Obviously, if the development's going to take place and the Peregrine Corporation prepared to spend some money in the area, I think there might be a good opportunity there for council to improve public realm and try to also have a more of a partnership discussion with them to see what we could do in Union Street. It's a beautiful street, heritage on both sides to some degree. It's
really awesome.
Yeah, really awesome, that's right. So really nice and bright. So yeah, I think there'll be possibly other opportunities to explore, so we might bring that as a separate motion, but look, this will be part of the discussion, so it'll be good to see if we can get an outcome for this, guys.
Councillor Moran, did you wish to speak as seconder?
Just to say what I said before, that I know these people have put an application in. I've got a copy of the application. If something's gone slip, twixt the lip and the cup or something, but I'd be very embarrassed to see the large Peregrine group get their protuberance and not the little guy that's been running that so successfully. So it's a tiny little place, but it's just chock a block. So thank you. Yeah, good mix, mate.
Well, man.
Thanks, Chair. I'd just like to ask a question. I mean, quite clearly that car parking is general report to the sustainability of UCN. But with regards to Director St. David's Park, with regards to the planning on Run the Road on East Terrace with regards to Obama, I'm assuming that would be coming back to members fairly soon. Do you have any insight as to when that may be the case?
Well, that's fairly important.
That's the bigger picture.
Through you, Chair. Yes, Lord Mayor, and as recently as last week, we met with our colleagues in Dipti to attempt to finalise a petition. So there will be two plans developed, and both of which will be including the maximum number of car parks, and certainly the expectation that has the four in front of it, Lord Mayor. One option will, however, include pedestrian activated crossing, so there may need to be some trade-off and conversation around pedestrian safety and number of car parks, but certainly the maximum number of car parks will be in there, as we discussed on another occasion.
Okay, thank you. I support the.
Anyone else wish to speak to this motion? Do you, that summed up, all those in favour? That's carried. Thank you, Councillor Abiad, for that sensible motion. That brings us to item 14, which is a motion to exclude so that we can consider a confidential item in relation to Town Hall Cafe. Can I have someone move the notice of exclusion? Moved by Councillor Vershaw, seconded by Councillor Corbell. Anyone wish to speak to the exclusion motion? Okay, that means I can put it. All those in favour? That is carried. So members of the public, members of staff who are not associated with this item, so that is all members of the public and those members of staff who are not associated with the item, please leave the chamber so that we can consider this next item in confidence. to give a moment for the doors to be reopened and for our cameras to be put back on. Now that the doors are open, I will declare this meeting closed and hand over to Councillor Abbey for the next meeting. Thank you.
Great strength.
You haven't got a quorum in front.
So if anyone wants to have a quick couple of minute break, it's until we hopefully have quorum in a couple of minutes. And then we'll start the next meeting. Councillor Hender.
And also need to
read this again.
Yes. Oh, not that one. Sorry, I've just played that. If you didn't get it, sorry. Oh, good.
Lama, and we don't have any current public forum. I believe we do have a deputation.
We do have deputation.
That's correct. So we do have a deputation from Sally and John Gamble in relation to item 10. Is Sally and John? Hello, how are you? Sorry to keep you waiting with the previous agenda. Members, with that in mind, I will move to items on block. Now, we do have a workshop at items. We don't have any workshops. So we have items to do with on block, including item 10. Members, before I do so, I might take into account that we have a deputation relating to item 10, and I might deal with that item first. So, well, I might pull that item out, definitely. So let's see if we can deal with the rest on block. So item 8, well, I will pull it out from the chair to hear the deputation. I'll prefer that we pull it out, hear the deputation and make a decision on it. I think that's a fair process, Councillor Mayor. So item 8, asset management plans. Would anyone like to pull that out?
Oh, no, that was impossible.
Thank you. Item 9, delegation of authority for award of contract of paving, pavement marketing services, the Lord Mayor. Marking, sorry. Item 10, we're dealing with later. Item 11, section 270, internal review of decision, laneway closure and outdoor dining permits. None. And then 12, quarterly board procurement report. Item 13, out of session papers for committee to receive a note, there's nil, and we'll discuss other business. So can I have a mover move item 8 and 11 and 12? Thank you. Councillor Malani, seconded by the Lord Mayor. Any debate? Be it that there's none, I put that. All those in favour? Councillor Wilkinson, you're voting. All those against? Those items are carried. Members, before we consider... there's one more item, sorry, I apologise, members. Can I have someone move the confirmation of minutes to the last meeting? I missed that item. Moved by Councillor Martin, seconded by the Deputy Lord Mayor. Thank you. Any debate? I put that. All those in favour? All those against? Also, the minutes have been confirmed. If I could invite Sally and John Gamble just to address the committee on item 10 in the way of deputation.
Thank you, Mayor.
Please come grab a seat with us. Yes, please, if you like. Sally and John, thank you for joining us. You have 5 minutes to present to this committee, and at the end of 5 minutes, if members have any questions to ask, they'll forward those to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I sincerely hope we don't appear to be serial pests over this tree.
No. Never. Please go ahead.
Thank you. I've made some notes here, and I won't have to read from the notes because I'm not very good on my feet. But I just want to say, over the past 12 years or so, we've totally renovated 3 townhouses on 326 Angus Street. These units are in immediate proximity to this accursed tree. We've not in all that time experienced a single crack in a wall or a concrete slab or a brick fence. There is paver upheaval right at the base of the tree. It does not impede access to the adjacent carport. The upheaval can, if were supposed to, be easily smoothed out. Unit 3/326 is closest to the tree, being a mere 3 to 4 metres away from the base. Now, the previous owners of 3326 alleged, among many other things, that there was cracking in the carport slab and in adjoining walls attributable to the tree. So that's simply not true. We rebutted all of the allegations about the tree that were made by the previous owner in correspondence to Ombudsman and Council. We have just had no cracks in it. We have an open stormwater drain in the courtyard 2 metres from the base of the tree and 4 metres from 3326. The drain continues actually underneath the number 326 units and is not in our time for any sign of root incursion. And we have proof of that as a result of plumbing scans. The tree base is also in immediate proximity to the largest stormwater drain in Angus Court, leading out to Angus Street. It's never been blocked, and there's no indication of root incursion. There has in the past been mention of SA Water having expressed some concern about the tree base being close to the entrance to this drain, and this did not appear in any FOI material. Water from the deluges over recent weeks flows downslope toward our premises. The flood water was totally discharged. I must note that several years ago, during a similar deluge, we and the residents of 324 Angus Street did experience flooding. The cause was twofold. Part of an old earthenware drain at 324 Angus Street was blocked by tree roots. The site of this blockage is some 40 metres from the base of the pepper tree. The residents of 324 have since removed over five or six trees in the shared driveway, and we have removed four more from 322 Angus Street at their insistence. Secondly, the flooding we experienced at 326 on that occasion was due to accumulated debris and mud compacting our drain and not tree roots. And there are two other trees much closer to 324. One is a pinus and one an ash, which are both listed in the SA Invasive Trees Register. Now, the pepper tree is not listed in this register. However, I accept that a search by the council staff has found it listed in WA, which I congratulate them for that. Dean Nicholas pointed out that any tree will send out roots in search of water, and notes that the pepper tree genus is relatively deep-rooted. We think it's reasonable to assume that this mature and healthy specimen has established its water sources deep down many years ago. It's been there some 40 years. Sally and I have consistently asked council that any decision to remove this tree be based on empirical evidence of having caused damage to property. Now, I really want to stress this point. No effort has been made by any council employee in all this time to produce factual evidence or even contact us to conduct an inspection of our property. In the latest report that's been handed to this committee, there is reference to council staff inspections having been carried out and having, and I quote, highlighted considerable cracking in the common wall and cracks in the concrete floor of the carport located adjacent in 326 Angus Street. Now, we own this property. Neither Sally nor I have ever been advised of such an inspection having been conducted. We've never had a report from council to this effect, and there is no cracking. We've asked repeatedly for evidence of damage to other residences in Angus Court and received no evidence of damage nor of any inspection having taken place. Number one Angus Court is the other residence in the immediate vicinity of the tree. This property is used for holiday letting, and the owner has informed us that he was not a respondent to the survey conducted in 2014. The only inspection of the precinct of which we are aware, and incidentally which was not disclosed within the FOI material, is that now disclosed in this recent report as having been conducted in December 2011 by URS Australia from Brighton Limited.
Mr. Gunn,
generally as a result of that,
the 5 minutes is up, memo. But I'm going to allow you to continue with your sentence, but the 5 minutes is up, so you've got, so please finish off as you present.
I'll give you a no. Thank you. As a result of that report, Mr. Kent Williams, in an internal memo headed Angus Court Structural Report, concluded this decision has now come through. The decision now this has come through is strong to retain the tree, which we will do now. This report, which has been handed to the committee by the council's advisors, refers to three prior experts' reports, one by FMG Engineering in March 2011. And others have been dismissed, including Dean Nibble's report. So the judgment has come down in favour of a 2011 report by FMG, which is inconclusive, but opts for removal on the tree on the basis that it might cause some damage in the future. I don't want to say any more, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ulysses, again. We'll just give us a minute. I might have a few minutes, but I might have some questions for you, so you can elaborate on. Members, any questions? Councillor Wilkinson.
Is this the development?
Councillor, do you mind using your mic? Thank you.
Is this the townhouse development opposite these terrace where two magnificent pine trees have just been removed in front on Central Drive?
No, I think not.
That's further down.
Councillor Martin, then Deputy Lord Mayor.
Yeah, look, just a very simple question. I've read all the paperwork and the letters and the replies and so on. Why do you want to keep the tree? We actually think it's a statuesque, shade giving, bird sheltering tree which is doing no harm. We're not fanatics. But without it we're going to lose serious shade cover. And we just don't see what the fuss is all about. Apologise for taking up everybody's time with us.
Thank you, Councillor. Deputy Lord Mayor. Councillor, do you have another question? You'd like to. So, any other further questions of Mr. and Mrs. Gamble? Thank you so much for joining us. The committee will now consider the item.
Much appreciated.
Just 1 second, I've got Councillor Wilkinson with his hand up with item 10. So, Councillor Wilkinson, you flagged you would like to move something.
Yes, I'd like to move that the tree is changed.
Okay. Thank you, Councillor. So just to assist you with this, from what I can understand is you would like to move that the tree is retained.
Yeah.
So with that, you may want to consider looking at item 5, which says, based on the merits review conducted, confirms its decision to approve the removal. How would you like to change that? Because everything else doesn't refer to anything else.
Delete that paragraph
then. Okay, so confirms it has conducted merits review decision to removal. So you'd like to remove item 4 and item 5?
Yeah, or rescind to the confirm the change to rescind.
Just to get clarity, so taking item 4 out and item 5, paragraph 4 and 5.
And 7 too.
And 7. Yeah.
Yes, and 7. Thank you.
So does everyone have clarity on what Councillor Wilkinson is moving? I've got a second there, Councillor Moran. Yeah. Yes, but some not there. Excellent. Councillor Yelverfull.
Thank you. I design townhouse developments as my job and design them in and around trees. I've done 2 or 3 developments around pepcorn trees. I'm very familiar, dealt with engineers and all of the stuff like that. There are always tree haters that will engage at some consultant to say that they want to get rid of the tree because they want to live in Terra Nullius land. The trees are what makes beautiful pictures that defend ordinary 1980s townhouses. What makes that development is the retained trees, the removal of that development. That's what makes it. And they had amenity. It's not doing damage. The report that said it was okay, I'm not quite sure how that not made its way to us. But the tree is clearly only causing very superficial lifting of a concrete flagstone near it, and that's the extent of the damage. And when engineers, even in the 80s, designed near a building like this, they designed the footings knowing that the tree was already there, and they designed the footings to allow for that. It's different if the tree came after the building, but that tree was there before the building and the engineers have designed it. That is why there is no cracking, because the engineers have designed it. That doesn't stop people getting consultants to try and say that it might cause getting in the future. But we're trying to be a green council, and you want to be a green council, and the carbon content of CO2 absorbing capacity of this enormous estate and habitat is far more consequential than us planting a few saplings around the place. So, I'm sure there's going to be, I'm going to lose a few votes and people want to remove the tree, I'm sure, but interesting to be a picture. We're trying to be a green council, and that being green is actually keeping trees, not proceeding to requests from the creators to get them.
Councillor Wilkinson, and a seconder, Councillor Moran, before you proceed. In reviewing your motion before us, you're basically noting the reports, which basically notes status quo, not removal, not confirming that we keep. If you would like to strengthen your motion, you have an opportunity at which to include another line. And my advice would be that you would move to retain the tree in that line, so something along these lines. Is there anything you'd like to give me so we could note and maybe get the seconder to also vote on our support?
I deserve that tree be retained.
Yep.
And that my better action is
so you Councillor Moran, you happy with that? Okay. So can I just seek leave to vary from the committee?
Paragraph on page 15. It's recommended that confidential power. Number one in this court, which has been displaced, being removed, and we've relayed and replaced with a more flexible material.
Yeah, Councillor, this is not an item.
That's the background.
Yeah, that's the background, so there's nothing to do there. Okay. So, Councillor Wilkinson, just in the sake of dealing with this item as quickly as we can, it seems like we've got good support here. This provides the noting and also says very clearly now that you're moving to retain the tree. Councillor Moran.
No further action other than remedial work for paving around the base of the tree be undertaken.
No. So, Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Moran is happy with that. Can I seek leave to vary from the committee, please? All those in favour, yes, seek to leave, so that's a varied. Councillor Moran is the seconder. So we've got Councillor Malani with a question. And Councillor.
Thank you. Yes, I don't have a problem with this motion, but I just want to ask the administration for some comment. I don't know who I'm asking. it's legal. It's liability based. I would brought in some additional expertise, I see. My question is, like I said, I don't have a problem with the motion moved. I just purely am interested in the liability of council in this matter if the tree is retained.
Through the chair, thank you, councillor, for your question. I think if you go to the report, paragraph 13 of the report includes relevant excerpt from section 245 of the Local Government Act. Section 245 of the Local Government Act provides effectively a mechanism for a person who's aggrieved about a tree located on a council road to contact the council and advise that the tree is causing damage. Once a person makes that notification, the council has an obligation to assess the nature of the alleged damage and determine what reasonable action is required in relation to the tree. Now, what is reasonable in any given circumstance is obviously going to be determined by the nature of the professional information that you have. If it is determined that whatever decision you make in relation to the tree is not reasonable, after you've been notified about damage, then the protection that you otherwise have against liability from any damage that that tree causes falls away, and you may be determined to be liable for negligence for any damage that the tree subsequently causes to property. So there's a couple of ifs and buts stages through there. Effectively, what this provision does is modify the ordinary common law in relation to negligence to give the council protection, but provided it takes reasonable action in relation to trucks. What's reasonable will ultimately be assessed by planning court determining the application for it about damage. And that's a matter for professionals, not a matter for legal argument.
Councillor Maloney, you're satisfied with that answer? Any other questions?
I'm just leaving it as a question for now.
Okay, so Deputy Lord Mayor, I think you put your hand up then, Councillor Maloney.
I also simply had a question that relates to, given that we're not in the business of killing trees for the sake of it, can someone just talk me through why, what Jennifer, we did have some complaints from neighbours, and do the complaints suggest that their property is being damaged, which is what was said from
through the chair, we have received a number of previous complaints from other residents within the area, and throughout the Section 270 process, we've been getting correspondence from those other adjacent owners asking about the progress of the tree removal.
So my question was about whether they had made an allegation that their property was being damaged. Because section 2452 talks about if an owner and occupier makes a request to take reasonable action to avert risk of damage to a property owner occupier. Is that what they've done?
Through the chair, yes, they have made allegations that their property is being damaged.
And have we made any assessment about that?
Through the chair, we've been receiving complaints from residents here for over 10 years. And I've been inside a couple of properties, and I've also seen some other damage at the location. I think what you've got here during this period, we can manage the canopy of the tree, we can look after that, we can reduce the branches, we can cut things back and keep that out of people's way, but we cannot manage the root system because of its location. So this is a conundrum for admin, in a sense, over a number of years now. And we've just come to the position, if you like, that the only way to manage this in the long term is to remove it. Because it is continually getting bigger, the trunk circumference is becoming larger as it lives, and those ramifications coming from that tree in the future, who knows?
So, just one further question, are you recommending the removal of the tree to preempt damage or because of existing damage?
The tree is currently damaging Adelaide Council's infrastructure, private property. Previous owner of the carport adjacent to the tree requested its removal before he sold that property in 2011, and took me into the carport and showed me the cracks in the floor of that premise. And I've also been into a couple of units where there is significant cracking in the walls. And as in line with most trees, where the canopy spreads, you get a drip line, and the root system of those trees tend to be out near that area. And lifting a few things in the backyard, you could see the roots near the back of the property.
Got Councillor Martin, Lord Mayor, and then yourself.
Just taking further along, in terms of the cracking that you're referring to, I know it's disputed, but are you certain that it's caused by the trees?
I think with any presence of such a large structure in the gardens of the properties adjacent, it has to have an impact on the soil moisture levels and therefore the soil movement. Whether it is wholly to cause, I'm not prepared to say that. There is some significant cracking in two of those properties that have a common wall.
Thank you.
Lord Mayor.
Thank Thanks, Chair. I think we answered just mildly conflicting messages in this discussion a little bit, Chair. But I understand that from those that did the deputation, Kent, they were saying it was their properties which would be most immediately affected by the tree, and there was no damage to their properties. Is that correct?
The previous owner of the carport that's directly adjacent to the tree has just contacted me, and I've looked inside of that carport area, and there are definitely cracks there. No doubt at all.
Okay, but in your opinion, the cracks are coming from the root system of the tree, is that your understanding?
That would be my opinion, yes.
And you're also saying that there is some mild damage to the public realm associated with the immediate...
Yeah, footpaths, curb and water table. There's a common fence there that's obviously been damaged by the trunk rot.
I guess that's so important, and you can trim the canopy, you can manage the canopy of the tree.
As we have done, Lord Mayor, over many years, we've reduced the canopy on a number of occasions at the request of the adjoining residents. But we can't do anything with the root system because of the location of the tree and the inability to put things like a root control barrier or some prevention structure in there to stop it growing further. We just can't fit it.
Ken, is there reasonable doubt that the tree is the cause of the damage? Or are you sure it is the cause of the damage? In your opinion?
I'm pretty certain. My experience tells me that I'm pretty certain that it's that. Lord Mayor, as I said, we yearned for this for some years, and we didn't take it out before because it is a nice big tree. There is no question about that, but it is in the wrong place, I believe.
But those properties which would be most immediately affected by the tree are the properties owned by the people doing the deputation.
On one side, yes.
On one side, yes.
Members, any further questions or comments? Councillor, let me get this. So Councillor Martin's already asked a question. Councillor Carrahan?
Just a question. I understand that the other property that's adjacent to the tree isn't owned by people who had our deputation, provided the deputation. Have we heard from any complaints from the people who bought the adjacent to the other property?
Through the Chair, as Tamara looked at previously, there has been constant contact with others asking where this has progressed, and they are obviously of a position that they're keen to know.
Can I just clarify, the new owners of the property that's been recently sold, have they complained?
I think you may be alluding to my reference to the carport, which was owned previously by Chairman Corbis de Vondima.
Yes. And is it new owner now?
I believe now that the gentleman that just did the presentation
owns that property.
Yes.
Okay, that's clarifies
things. I've just understood that from the discussion.
Okay, so.
Thank you, Councillor. Well, Bill, you had your hand up, and then Councillor Martin.
Yeah. I've got a couple of questions. The recommendations that were put forward by Dr. Nicole in January 2015, point 8 indicates that the tree is adequately distanced from residential dwellings and other substantial buildings of value, and that the report dated in March 2011 found no evidence of any damage to dwellings or any other substantial structures of value. And also 9, that the likelihood of tree roots entering PVC stormwater pipes is very low. So we are getting conflicting information because we've got this report, this is what we're referring to, this is an expert, and yet we're hearing from administration that's not necessarily the case. So it is a conflicting situation for us. I just wanted to get some more clarification from maybe the CEO or from the administration. Why is it that they've put forward these recommendations that we've removed the tree when we've had this recommendation from the expert?
And Ken, you can talk about the expert's advice.
If I may, through the Chair,
all the arborist reports and the engineering reports that we've had done previously over a number of years do actually have options to retain a tree. But in all of those reports, they also say that if those options are not practical and are not going to resolve some issues, tree removal is the only other option. So I think some of our documentation perhaps has been selective in what's been drawn out of it. So, does that help?
My other question is, legally, like with, is it sufficient background work that we've undertaken to protect council in the event that in future there are claims from local residents that the tree is causing damage, that we have done all of the groundwork necessary to cover all of our bases if we make the decision to take the tree? No, but what could I hear from the lawyer?
What could we do? I'm trying to attend some of
Thank you, Councillor. Through the chair, I think it'd probably be unwise of me to give legal advice about this particular case in a public forum. Notwithstanding that the present public gallery is not opposed to the retention of the tree, we are being broadcast live on the internet. And
well, the backyard is.
Yes, and what I'm saying is, it's also the case that everything that's discussed here is a matter of public record. So if the council resolves that it's happy to waive privilege and have me discuss matters of legal significance in a public forum, I'm happy to do that. But I think the council should turn its mind to whether or not it would be happy for that to occur publicly, given that, depending on what that advice is, there may or may not be consequences for the council from a risk and financial perspective.
Can we go and debate this? Nobody's going to answer this for us.
We've asked a question. So, members, Councillor Corbell, you've asked the question. Are you satisfied with the answer?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions? Before you do, Councillor, please, I've given you an opportunity, Deputy Lord Mayor. Any other councillors? Councillor Martin, you.
No, was answered. Thank you.
Yes, satisfied. So, Councillor Antic?
Yeah, my question is just we've heard from this afternoon that how many residents that want the tree removed are still there. I mean, are still living in the area. Are there any? We've heard that the property has been purchased now. One of the closest properties. But are there any in the surrounding area that have exhibited a willingness to have the tree or a wish to have the tree removed? Are still there?
Through the chair, it would be probably 2 years or so ago now. We let it drop the entire block around this location. To notify and give some opportunity to make comment. The response from that was a couple of strong yeses that should go. The rest was silent, and Mr. and Mrs. Gamble obviously didn't want to go. So that was the question we had.
Any other questions, Councillor?
Well, I think
okay, members, we've had an informed discussion about this. We've asked questions, we've heard a deputation, we've heard our staff. I'm really mindful of this process now. We've had the opportunity to review, we've asked questions. I'm happy to go into the debate process now, and I think more will come out of this if needs be. Some people have already spoken. I know Councillor Moran has reserved their right to speak, but be that there's no other questions at this stage, we never got off formal anyway, but Councillor Moran, you reserved your right. As a seconder, would you like to speak now? Or?
I would, but I'm happy to second this. Our Peters has not given us any strong reasons to shut the tree down, except an opinion, an engineering opinion that it might cause a crack. Now my house is cracking like you would not believe, and I have removed every little blade of grass around it, and it continues to crack just the same. And in fact, there would be a school of engineering thought that if you remove this tree that was there when the house was built, you'll actually change the water table to its detriment. If you build a house next to a mature tree, preserving a mature tree, you really just have to fix your cracks, alter your thing. The only liability, and I'm not a lawyer, so I beg to be, I think, the only real liability in my experience is when the house is in is structurally damaged to the point that it's dangerous. Now, these are just, we've had this before us many times, haven't we, Ken? And we've always voted to retain a tree, and I see no difference today. If a branch falls on, that those types of liability are when a dangerous branch is hanging over a house, and I gather we'll be keeping this canopy pruned. Council's told about it, it falls on the house at that house point. Trees be removed because of cracking when they're not seriously structural. And none of these are carport, a lifted paver, does not say to me that it's we're really in danger legally or in danger liability wise. In fact, we may well be more in danger if we take this large, and it's a beautiful peppercorn tree. It's very like, so you'll know, Francine Connor's peppercorn tree. Now, that could not be a peppercorn tree any closer to a house. In fact, the house is sort of leaning against it, and they would die rather than remove that tree. It's lifted a few pavers, there might be a bit of cracking, but that, they live with that because the house was built around the tree or with the tree. And so is this case. We haven't heard from anybody for 2 years. It sounds like these people who bought the house is most directly affected. I saw the pictures, they've got that little bit of a lifted paver next to a carport is the worst. Seriously, come and have a look at my house. Houses crack, and that particular section of Adelaide is on Bay of Biscay soil, which is reactive to moisture. Now, as I said, you can upset your moisture level more by taking a tree out. The roots, as the owner of the three surrounding properties has said, have never been a problem in stormwater, and they can be checked up by the official water people who have not been called out to clear roots out of the drain, because PVC drains are not like the old earthenware ones in North Adelaide, the old houses have, where the roots do get in, they do not get in PVC drains. So roots are no longer the problem of yesteryear. If we removed every tree that lifted a paver, I mean, God, you walk down Molesworth Street, half the wrought iron fences are like this, because our street tree's gone straight for the watered lawn at the front of the Molesworth houses. But those people would never dream of asking us to remove their street trees. And these are roots that have really caused significant damage to fences. But it's just a mindset. When if you let it drop an area saying, can I remove a tree, you'll always get two. I was surprised you only got two saying, chop the tree down. We've seen some tragic losses of trees, one in Jeffcott Street outside the large building there, where the people swore that the gum tree, and it's a gum tree, so they really are a problem, was causing cracking. They came and applied for it 3 or 4 times. It turned out when we eventually removed the trees, more cracking and subsidence occurred. So I suggest we give this tree a stay of execution, keep an eye on it. And predictions are not predictions that this tree is going to continue to grow, it will cause trouble. When I hear, look, this is pulling the side of a house down, we have had repeated visits from the sewerage people clearing the drains. That's when we should reconsider. But at the moment, we've got conflicting reports. We're not nowhere near being in trouble insurance-wise. A few facts cannot be proven to be a tree. So I think we're well and clear. I think we can give this tree another stay of execution and keep an eye on it, trim the canopy, and get some current. If there are current complaints from owners, we should monitor those and have a look. And go into their properties and see them. And I suggest that we go in and see these people's property to show that they have no idea that anybody's been there. So I think to chop a tree down with this information would be wrong. I think we need to keep an eye on the situation. If we start doing this, there's always one person in every street that wants all the trees removed. And so we I think we really need to. I came to this meeting thinking, oh, well, this is the final one. You know, I think that's how to chop it down now. But then when I reread it again, sitting here and listening to the proponents having bought the houses that were the complainants in the first place, I completely changed my mind. I'm seriously comfortable in voting this way.
Thank you, Councillor Moran. On 10 seconds. Perfect. Councillors, I've got the Councillor Antic, then we've got a few more.
Yeah, look, I think I completely agree with that. This is one of those situations where there's never going to be a clear answer immediately, but we do have a 40-year-old tree, and it's not something which is easily replaced. And I get all the potential liability issues, but I really don't think we're at that point at this stage. We're hearing from the Gambles who come in today, and they're as affected, if not more affected than anybody. And if we were going to take a position seriously, then I think it's theirs that we'd want to listen to. And they're certainly here in good faith. They're approaching this from a very sensible, non-emotive manner. And I think we talk green all the time. We've got a green city agenda, and we spend a lot of time planting concrete as part of that. I think it would be a terrible shame to actually turn our back on that and have a very, very significant tree. I mean, this is not a tree which is 5 years old or 2 years old or 10 years old. It's a 40-year-old tree. It's not replaced with a blink of an eye. I think we have to take a very conservative approach to this, and we have to listen to what the residents are saying, and to listen to the report, and certainly the Nicole report. He's a very well-regarded arborist, and he thinks it's worthy of being kept. So I agree entirely with what Councillor Moran says. I think I think it's incumbent on us to take a softly approach to this and continue to monitor it. And if things do progress, then we can readdress it then. But for the time being, it doesn't sound to me as though this is something we can't manage. So I'll support this amendment.
No, to the sake of time and efficiency, does anyone want to speak against this current motion or have any amendments? I'm happy to take a question, but if no one's going to speak against it. Okay, go ahead.
I'm still absolutely on the horns of the dilemma, just because I don't feel like I've got a proper grasp of the facts yet. So just let me explain what my problem is. We've got, since 2011, we've had complaints from neighbours saying that this is damaging their property. When that happens, according to the Act, the owner sort of shifts to us. We've been alerted to the fact that there might be damage to a neighbouring property, and therefore we become responsible for the damage to those neighbouring properties. Yeah? In this case, at least some of the neighbouring properties have been bought by the Gambles, and we can assume that they're not going to complain about the tree and so on. I still don't fully understand whether there is any other neighbouring property who has made an allegation that this tree is damaging the property now. That's my question.
Through the chair, there's two properties, units adjacent on the other side, which have continued to raise up with us.
And have we ourselves identified whether there is any cracking in their property? And do we have any?
Yes.
And have we got an arborist report that indicates that that is a result of the tree damage?
No, don't have an arborist report at the time.
So we don't have that. Okay. Well, I'd like to move an amendment, and maybe it could be that it could be adding in the words "for the time being," just that no further action be taken for the time being.
So
that we can give a bit of a watching brief on this, because it becomes apparent.
Deputy Lord Mayor, just in getting some brief advice from our administration, their advice was, which may appeal to you, that to take everything into account as part of the discussion, and possibly Councillor Wilkinson, you might want to take this on board and might save amendments, is that there's a consideration given in item 4 that determined peppercorn tree located at Angus Court, Adelaide, be retained and monitored.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's kept under watch basically, yeah, to some degree.
Yeah.
Is that,
yeah,
give you,
yeah,
that's that, are you satisfied with that, Councillor?
Put it to the vote.
Just 1 second, please. So just there's some procedural elements, Councillor. So just, Councillor Wilkinson, you're satisfied? Thank you. Councillor Moran is a seconder. Can I get leave to vary? Thank you very much. That is now varied. With that in mind, thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor. I think you strengthened their position. Members, Councillor Wilkinson, to sum up.
I am a big advocate of council using roof barriers rather than tree removal as a solution to these problems. I really get people complaining about trees affecting the house and things like that. When it's a council street tree, council has the option of the roof barrier, usually 2 metres deep, just on the footpath inside the fence line. Maybe there's a reluctance to do it because there's a cost associated with doing it, but if you want to keep our trees, we're treating the green council, they will spend money putting the roof barriers rather than chopping down the trees. In this instance, you know, if down the track it turned out there was cracking to a house that should have been engineered for the tree, couldn't have seen it, then a root barrier should be put in just outside the footing line of the house, well, not right next to the trees, but right back on the line of the townhouse. That's the future solution that we should be looking at, not chopping down the tree. I'm sorry, we're looking at root barriers, not chopping down trees, as a solution.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. With our members, can I put this to you? All those in favour? Lord Mayor, all those against? That is carried. We can move on to the next item. Thank you very much for your deputation. So, members, we've dealt with all items on block. I'll move to other business. Oh, sorry. Item 9, Lord Mayor, apologies. Delegation of authority for award of contract for pavement marking services. You pulled that one. Are you moving as recommended or an amendment?
Chair, I am moving as recommended and I seek a seconder. I just have questions first, Chair.
Not a problem. So can I get a seconder? Seconded by Councillor Martin. Lord Mayor, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Chair. I've read the report, it's all self-explanatory. I've just really got one, but it's a fairly question, Chair, but it's a fairly important one. Is that it looks that the recommendation is to reappoint the existing contractor who's managed this on behalf of council in the past. That's fine, I'm not questioning that whatsoever. And I look at the criteria around cost and ability and capacity in the right, Chair. What my question is regards to quality. In terms of durability, it's something I've mentioned in the past, but just in terms of the longevity of the paint choice which we use or our contractors use, seems to be extraordinarily limited. I say this as a layman, I'm not pretending to be an expert, but I notice that when we reseal a road and we re-bitumise a road, sometimes within a period of as little as 12 months, the paint is degraded considerably. My question is one of quality. Are we working with a contractor that is providing us with the appropriate level of quality so we're actually getting, even if that does cost more, so that we're actually getting more longevity from what we're buying?
Lord Mayor, I'll take your question on board that it's not related to the topic. The motion before us is to approve the award of the contract or not approve the award of the contract. These sort of questions are not relating to this specific item. So you're prepared to take that offline, being that you've moved it? Because this is not going to affect the decision of this committee.
No, but it is material, though, Chair. In as far as is we about to, this is not an inconsequential sum of money. If we are, I look for the comfort that we, and it's something I brought up offline before. And the decision on which we're about to vote will be predicated on the fact that whoever would get this company, ultimately, should they receive this contract,
will be using a better quality mat.
Correct. Thank you. Well, Mayor, you've got all your answers. Members, I'll see Councillor Wilkinson's hand up. Is anyone going to speak against approving this contract or potentially convince any other member to do so? If not, I'm going to sum up. I'm going to take any questions offline, Councillor. I'm pretty serious. Time is really fine. So if it's not relating directly to the motion.
Well, it is.
Okay, happy to hear you out, Professor.
Council has council staff that do line marking. Why, and we're doing line marking all the time. Why are we doing this? Why, like before we left the contract for another 3 years, in which case we're locked into this, why are we sub-tendering line marking when we have council staff that do the line marking?
Tom, thank you.
Through the chair, volume. Quite simply, based on volume, what we've got is the host contractor is experienced in dealing with major road infrastructure. Our line marking teams deal with all the other details in regards to parking bays, etc.
You're satisfied, Councillor?
And it's a small team.
Yep.
My next question is we're reviewing our urban design framework. And part of that review is looking at nude streets, which means less line marking, not more line marking. How does, if we adopt a policy of a nude street scene where we're doing less than half the amount of line marking, will this contract lock us into the myriad of line marking that we're currently doing?
The tender was based on the amount of line marking that is currently planned in our asset management plans moving forward.
So that means that if we want to go to a nude street thing with less than half the amount of line marking, that we're still going to get charged for more line marking than we're actually doing.
We are only going to get charged for the amount that we use.
Okay, so we can pull back on it.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Councillors, Lord Mayor, to sum up.
Summed up, Chair.
I put that. All those in favour? All those against? No, it's carried. Members, any other items on item 14? If there's none, can I ask someone please move the exclusion to consider items 16 and 17, moved by Councillor Mulani, and then seconded by Councillor Corbell for item 16. All those in favour of the exclusion? All those against? Members, can I get a clear show of hands? All those against the exclusion? Thank you. Everyone's picked up. Great, fantastic. So we'll get back on track. Everyone voting again in item 17, voting to exclude, all in favour? All against? That is also carried. Just 1 second, Councillor. Can I just ask any members of the public that are not directly related to those items or staff to please exit the committee room? And Councillor Antic?
Is he doing that in public or no?
We love to do it in public. Yep, you can speak.
Yeah, I've got the whole
thing in public. Which item?
Item 16.
Yes,
yeah. Yeah.
Thank you, Matt. Members, and I close the meeting at 8:43 p.m. and thank you for your patience. So,